Good morning. Today we have a special guest in our studios, General Bikram Singh, the former Chief of Army Staff. The General has vast experience, having served for 42 years in the Army and 5 years in the corporate sector as Independent Director. We are hosting the program Leadership Series with the General, and I'm your host, Vinod Lamba. My fellow anchors are...
Hello, and I'm Dolly Bhardwaj.
Hello, I'm Harshpreet Kaur.
So, welcome to Chitkara University.
Thank you so much.
It is indeed a great pleasure for us.
Thank you so much. Thank you very much.
So, my first question to you is, sir, with your military background, sir, having served for so long, how do you define leadership, number one? And what is it that a person should do to become an effective leader?
Right. Firstly, good morning and Jai Hind to all of you. Pleasure being here, and let me at the outset thank the faculty of this very beautiful, very distinguished institution, Chitkara University, to give me this opportunity. It's a pleasure interacting with you and on a subject which is very close to my heart. As was brought out, it's not just 42 years in the Army, but also the experience of the corporate sector, plus also speaking to various corporate houses, to the business institutions. I have been going and speaking on the subject of leadership, management and strategy. Now, coming on to your question, you know, there are a large number of definitions as far as leadership is concerned. If you get onto the internet, you'll find a number of definitions that have been given out by various experts, various authors. But with my experience, I would define leadership as the art of influencing people. It's the art of influencing people with the aim of obtaining their willing commitment for the accomplishment of collective goals. So you see, I have emphasized few words in this. One is art. Art means you all are leaders. You all can learn it. You know, art of painting, dancing, singing. It's an art. So in other words, it's something which you can acquire. Anybody can be a good leader, provided you take pains to become one. That's number one. Number two, I talked about influencing. It's all about influencing. You know, if you have to take a team along, you've got to influence the people who are under you. And you influence those people with your communications, with your behavior, with your conduct, with your mannerism. So you also, along with this, provide the purpose. Sorry. Because unless you provide the purpose to your team as to why you are doing a thing, you'll find they will not be understanding it. Purpose gives the reason to people to do a particular job in a particular way that you want them to do. So purpose has to be defined. And so once you do this, you'll find people will come along. And I use the word again, you know, collective. I said collective goals. Collective goals, that's what leadership is all about. It's not about leaders' own personal aspirations and goals. It's a collective goals. And when you talk of willing commitment, it underscores motivation, inspiration, which is there in the team, which comes up with camaraderie, with spirit decor. And that's the kind of, you know, that glue you have to build, which binds the team together to be able to be successful. And coming to your second part of your question, what a leader should do to be able to be successful.
Yes.
Let me sum it up in one word, you know, for you students. That is trust. Trust, trust, trust. If you can earn the trust of your team, you will be an effective leader. And earning trust, I'm using the word earning. It's not that, you know, you can purchase trust or demand trust or order trust. No. Trust is something which is earned over the years. It's earned by your deeds, the way you behave, by the way you conduct yourself. A good leader is committed to the aspirations of his team members, every individual. And mind you, every individual is an institution. I have a number of times brought it earlier out that don't use one size fits all while dealing with your team members. I mean, each person being an institution, an individual, requires a particular way of handling.
Sure.
So you've got to be caring, you've got to address their needs. You've got to be ensuring that they get time with their families. In fact, you know, needs is the main thing. In the military, we generally are told to read Edwin G. Boring. You know, he's the author of a book called Psychology for the Armed Forces. In that, the needs are defined as primary and secondary needs. Whereas Maslow theory of needs, when you look at that, it defines the needs, you know, the hierarchy of the needs. There are 5 needs he has given out. It's starting off with psychological needs, then coming on to safety needs, your social needs, esteem needs, and then your self-actualization needs. But when you compare the two, basically same. Primary needs are psychological needs as per Maslow. And the remainder needs come as per what he said. So if you're looking at your team members, you address their aspirations in terms of their social needs, you give them time. It's not that, you must have seen, we don't put soldiers, you know, why it's a 24, 365 days commitment in the military. We give time to our soldiers to be with their families. We give them time even from field areas to go down to their families four times in a year. So addressing the aspirations of your workers, of your employees, of your team members is something which is going to build trust. And you've got to walk the talk. You can't have double standards. You've got to champion the organizational values. Every organization has got values, and you'll find them on the web page of every particular organization. A leader has to champion those values. Unless he does, he or she does that, he or she will not be an effective leader. So to do that, it's a commitment towards, I would say, excellence, which all the time a leader has to display, both on duty while with the workforce and even during the off parade hours, off office hours. So that is important. So you've got to be a well-rounded personality as a leader to be able to get the willing, you know, commitment of your people by being a leader of character and competence. How many of you have seen my TEDx talk on character and competence, the hallmarks of an effective leader? You better see that, and you'll understand what I mean in that. Character is your values and your attributes that makes the character, and competencies are your skill sets that you need to acquire to be able to do well. So if you're a competent leader, people will follow you. You'll be effective.
Sir, I would like to ask you the next question.
Yeah.
Sir, leadership prevails everywhere, in every arena. How would you differentiate between the leadership in the military arena and in the different fields?
I think excellent question. What you said, that, you know, leadership prevails in every arena. The fundamentals of leadership are same. The principles, the tenets of leadership are same, no matter whether it's military or corporate sector, for that matter, any field of human endeavor, you will find that the fundamentals are same. But the difference which comes in is with regard to the goals, with regard to the environment you're operating in, with regard to the methodology that you're adopting to fulfill those, achieve those goals. And the kind of, you know, nurturing that you have to do, the type of mental and emotional conditioning that you have to do of your employees and your members of your team is different. So let me just explain this. For example, you know, goals. For example, you know, we have in the military, our goals are, you know, national sovereignty, unity, and integrity of the country. Whereas you'll find in the case of corporate sector, you are basically pursuing chasing profits. You want to have profits. Very simple, revenues and profits, ultimately, that's what you're looking at. So each organization has got a different goal. And to achieve those goals, the methodology has got to be a different thing. You know, we use kinetic, non-kinetic means. You use only non-kinetic means. The other thing is the environment. Ours is a very, very stressful environment. The levels of leadership have got to be ultimate, because the kind of stress levels are phenomenal. You'll be amazed. It's a very chaotic, it's a very disorderly arena, battlefield arena, where the change is so fast. You know, change is the only constant, as you know, but change on the battlefield is so fast, and at times in quantum also it is so much, and there is so much of disruption taking place on the battlefield, that you got to be a leader with mental agility, with versatility, otherwise you cannot operate over there. So the emphasis of the military is in creating versatile, mentally agile leaders, you know, who can sense what the adversary is going to do next. So time is the next thing which comes in. You know, you'll have a lot of time in the business world
to deal with your competitors.
Here, to deal with your adversary, you've got to think and in a jiffy take action. It's basically cutting down your OODA cycle, where observe, orientate, decide and act. This loop which is there every time you take a decision has got to be shortened. If you don't shorten it, you're going to be reactive. And on the battlefield, you've got to be aggressive, proactive. And if you're going to be proactive, you've got to shorten the OODA loop vis-a-vis the adversary to be able to have that, you know, ascendancy over the adversary. So the challenges are many. The other thing I would say is that, you know, the difference I would say is that we lay emphasis on creating leaders and not managers. Now, most of you, you know, who are pursuing masters in business administration would say, well, look, because these two terms are used interchangeably most of the time. But there is a difference between a leader and a manager. And let me tell you, how can you differentiate? The organizations that are being led by managers, you will find people will come at 9 in the morning and leave at 5. But organizations which are being led by leaders, you will find people coming on their own, some of them coming in the morning at 6 and leaving at 10 at night. Why? Because there is ownership of the goals of the organization. A manager cannot create that. It's the leader that creates that ownership of the goals of the organization. So with that in mind, if you see, our approach is very different. So we emphasize on creating leaders and not managers. So this is how you find the difference which is over there. But yes, there are other differences as well. As I said earlier, the methodology that you use, the environment is totally different. And it's a lifelong commitment. The readiness of a leader is far too much. Like, for example, you know, at times when I approach some people of some corporate houses, you'll find an email getting back to you. I'm off on a vacation for 15 days. Approach me by so-and-so date. This doesn't happen in the military, in the army. It's 24/7, 365. So even when a person is on leave, he's available. He's accessible to his command. It doesn't mean he's interfering. No. We develop our officiating incumbents. We give them opportunity to grow. But he's available. Leader, he or she is available to the command all the time. So that's the difference broadly.
So, sir, till now we talked about leadership in a more general way, but you also told us that army leadership is another level of leadership. So can we at this point focus more on the components of army's idea of leadership, army's structure of leadership?
You're talking about the architecture which is there. Yeah, you see, all organizations, you know, have an architecture. They have various processes, programs to develop their leaders. In the military, in the army, it's a full-time commitment, and we give topmost priority to the development of leaders. Right from the time an officer, he or she joins the military, or for that matter, even a rustic, youth who's picked up to join the ranks, we develop that leader, you know, that soldier to come up as a non-commissioned officer, as a junior commissioned officer, till he gets an honorary rank. So the leadership is not only officers in the military. Leadership is your officers, junior commissioned officers, and non-commissioned officers. It's a teamwork. All of them operate at various levels. So when you look at our architecture, as I said earlier, it's a full-time commitment. It's an enduring commitment. We give topmost priority to it. We create leaders, not managers. Our focus is on that. So broadly, this is what our architecture is. And the other thing is that, you know, we have, as per our architecture and given the levels of our leadership, we have the direct leaders, we have the organizational leaders, and we have the strategic leaders. So our training for the three levels is done in a very gradual, logical, systematic manner. Whereas you will find in the corporate sector, because corporate sector strength is not much, you will have some corporate sector having at best, you know, 500 people, 1,000 people, 5,000 people. So what you do is you have direct leadership. Direct leadership is which is face-to-face leadership. People, you know, working on the factory floor, people working on the shop floor, doing the basic work on machines and basic manufacturing the goods. That is a direct leadership. And then as you rise up, the people who are leading that organization are the strategic leaders, leaders who create the vision, leaders who create the, you know, macro plans, strategies to achieve that vision. So there's a different level architecture. Caters for all these three levels. Number one, it's a graduated process. Plus also, I want to tell you that today, a lot of things are changing pretty fast. You know, the new concepts are coming in, new trends are coming in into leadership. You have new thought process with regard to leadership. So to make sure that our leaders remain, relevant with regard to the latest, trends which are there, the latest best practices, we send our people across to your institution, for example. You have people coming and doing MBAs over here. Correspondence courses also with various universities. So we send across people to learn these things. So our architecture also ensures that we keep our leaders relevant with the changing realities in the environment with regard to leadership and hone them with the latest skills.
There are actually two views about leadership. One is that people say that leaders are born, and the other is that leaders are made. Now, what is the anatomy of an effective leader, and is there a tailor-made pattern where a person can shape himself to be an effective leader?
Yes, that's an excellent question. You see, people generally, when you see various articles, you read various articles, you'll find three, four aspects of a leader being mentioned by various authors. But if you want to have a comprehensive look, I mean, you ladies and gentlemen seated here, you know, the future leaders of this country and even global leaders, there are three facets, there are three components of a leader. One are the attributes, the second are the skills, the competencies, and third are the ethics. I talked of character and competence. You know, character comprises your attributes. Attributes are mental, they are physical, they are emotional. We can talk about these in the subsequent sessions if you wish to have. And then you have the competencies, you know, which are your technical competencies, which enable you to do the basic job of yours wherever you go. So whatever you have been assigned, the ability to be able to perform that job. Then you have your conceptual skills, that is to be able to deal with higher, you know, I was just telling the Harpreet, right? Harshpreet. I was telling Harshpreet that as our people rise to the strategic level, that's where the conceptual skills come in. You get my point. So that's it. So you have the technical skills, you have the conceptual skills, and then you have the interpersonal skills. To be able to communicate with your leaders. Unless a leader is able to communicate with the team, the leader will not be able to tell the team what exactly he or she wants them to do. So interpersonal skills are very important, and it is not just interpersonal skills is not just being able to communicate. It's also the art of listening. A good leader, to be an effective leader, has got to be a good listener. Listen to your team. They will tell you large number of points. But if you're only going to be one-way traffic of passing on directions, do this, do this, do this, you will never be able to create a healthy team. So listening is a very important thing again. And again, third important thing in interpersonal, you know, communications is that you should be able to understand the non-verbal communications from the people. You know, the students seated here, each one of them is conveying a different body language, a non-verbal communication which I can read, and if you ask me after this, I'll tell you what exactly it is. So we all communicate non-verbally as well. A leader has to be a master of all this to be able to do well.
Sir, we respect our soldiers a lot. So I would like to know what exactly motivates them and prepares them each day for the ultimate sacrifice in the line of duty.
I talked of briefly about the mental conditioning, mental, emotional and physical conditioning of our soldiers. It's done in a very, very systematic manner. And how do we do this? This is done in the backdrop of the organizational values. It is done in the backdrop of the soldier's creed. Now, let me just give you some highlights of this. For example, you have the values are, you know, your integrity, your loyalty, duty, respect, selfless service, courage, moral courage, honor. These are the values which we teach, and it is not teaching, let me tell you. In the military, the difference is that we make our people, our soldiers, practice and live those values till they become a habit. That's the difference. So you'll find that the conditioning is such that a person is a value-based soldier. He has loyalties to the constitution, he has the loyalties to the Indian Army, he has the loyalties to his regiment, and he has the loyalty to the battalion that he's fighting for. And mind you, a soldier fights for his regiment. Some of you may be having a, you know, the military background, your dad's parents may be in the military, you would be knowing about it. A soldier fights for his unit, the name of his unit, Naam Namak Nishan. So that motivation comes in with the conditioning that we do. And of course, the needs. You find leaders leading from the front. You got to show the way. The leader has to show the way. You got to lead them from the front. Now, a lot of people tell me when I speak at corporate houses and at business, you know, institutions, that sir, by leading from the front, are you not taking away the initiative of your subordinates? No. A leader is not always leading from the front. He only comes about, he, you know, jumps everybody else and comes to the front when the situation so demands. You know, when the movement of the team stops, when they are confronted with a situation which is marked by very, very high levels of volatility, uncertainty, complexity, ambiguity, that's the time the leader comes forward and leads from the front. So it is not across the board. It's not every time that the leader is in front, because that would be debarring your subordinates to develop as good leaders. You've got to give them initiative. So broadly, I would say this is the reason that it is the allegiance, the loyalty to the goals, aims, certain values that he goes and he sacrifices his life. The other thing is, you know, which actually gives the confidence to a soldier, let me tell you, is a belief that if something happens to him, his family would be looked after. So what the soldier sees is, you know, when he's fighting in Jammu and Kashmir and he sees his, you know, colleague who's died, and he sees the nation respecting the mortal remains of his colleague when it gets back to the village, the ministers going there and the members of the military senior leadership going over there, and they sees the administration people going over there and saluting, you know, he gets that confidence that, look, if something happens to me also, the country is going to look after me. So these things combined is something which gives. Nobody actually wants to die, but it's the call of duty. It's in the line of duty. If it has got to be done, well, a soldier don't look back, and he does it. And let me tell you a very interesting thing. In fact, in one of the you know, corporate houses where I was speaking, I was told by one gentleman after the talk that, look, sir, isn't it true that a soldier dies because he has no option? So I was surprised at that question of his. So I just asked them, I said, tell me how many companies have you changed ever since you joined this profession? He says, a four. So I said, a soldier does not do this job hopping. A soldier is committed to where he goes. He is going to live there and he is going to die over there. So when we are confronted, when a soldier is confronted with a difficult situation, when the going gets tough, it's a tough that gets going. Soldier doesn't give up. He doesn't run away from the battlefield. He doesn't change his job. So I had to tell him this. So remember, the loyalties are very high. The allegiance to the national, to the constitution, to the national aspirations, to the regiment, to the army are very high. And that's the reason that a soldier is prepared to make the ultimate sacrifice.
Sir, before we conclude, just one final question. We are living in an information age and there are various challenges to leadership. So what are these challenges and how can we overcome these challenges? Very briefly, sir.
When he says the information age, globalized world, things get passed on from one person to the other in a jiffy, in few seconds. Social media is over there. You basically, I think, yes. Referring to that. There are fake news, there are false rumors being spread. Well, what I would say is that as long as you go by your values, all parents give values to their children. And your institutions give you those values. So if you have a valid personality, you will be able to decipher what exactly is being given there in the social media. Don't jump at a thing. Don't just keep passing on a thing which has come to you. There's a trend I find today. You get a message and you pass on to five more people. I think today you can't do more than five. Earlier people used to do it to 1,000 people. So don't blindly do that. Read it. Understand it. What are the implications? What are the ramifications? Are you contributing to nation building? Are you contributing to national cohesion? Are you doing something good for the community or are you creating fissures? Are you creating problems by sending that? So as a good leader in the making, you people have got to see the second, third, fourth tier ramifications, second, third, fourth order ramifications of your passing on that message. So read a message well, discuss it with your parents, discuss with your faculty what it is and try and derive the correct meaning of it. He's absolutely right when you tell me this. The environment is highly vitiated. A lot of fake, false, information, rumors are being put across. And I think you as future leaders have got to be mindful of the fact that this is happening and continue to go through the, analyze that particular information through the prism of your values, of your intelligence, of your emotions. And do it in concert with your parents, your siblings, do it in concert with your faculty. And you'll never go wrong.
It is also important in the information age that the leaders are mentally agile and versatile, as I brought out earlier.
Sir, thank you very much for sharing your thoughts on leadership. It was indeed very, very informative.
Thank you.
With this, we conclude our program, Leadership with a Journal. Thank you and have a good day.